three title fights on the card. Let's start with the one at the very top. Here we go. Colby Covington loses to Kamaru Usman. Another way to say it is Kamaru Usman retains his UFC welterweight strap with a fifth round stoppage. Boy, there was Schadenfreude on Twitter yesterday. But let's start here when we talk about Kamaru Usman. Number one, Brian Campbell, let's assess how good of a welterweight he is historically. And two, whether his approach ultimately was part of the reason why he won. I'll actually pitch to you first on that.
Yeah.
Give me an assessment of how good you think he is. And is that less is more approach he took in the run-up to the fight more recently? Not the buffet fighting where he got all crazy, but this last 6 weeks, last 8 weeks, do you think that really made a difference in the end?
I think so. Look, how good is he? I think he's great. I think he's potential to make a run at the pound for pound top two or three here. I think he's showing you that in there by having a fight that we come for a wrestling match and a boxing match broke out, which was very interesting in the fact that neither broke code along the way. You had one pump fake of a takedown attempt from Kamaru Usman early, and then you went almost 25 full minutes with them just basically putting it all out there and saying, I think I got the better gas tank. I think I got the better chin. I think I'm tougher than you. Let's just keep jamming until one of us goes down. But I think for Usman, it showed that other side of him. He had made certain comments in the buildup, like I've only shown, what, 40% of how good I am. I wasn't overwhelmingly wowed by his striking, but this ended up being an even match in which they both put it all on the table, and he was the last man standing because of the things that led me to pick him leading up. I thought he was more aggressive when it matters. I thought he's a harder striker. I thought he had more of a natural instinct to want to finish somebody. Although this fight never got to the ground, we never really saw what would have happened. Would they naturally have canceled each other out with their wrestling? We don't actually know that. But in a boxing match, he won out with those categories in the end. And this was a gutsy-ass win in one of those, like, sneaky fight of the year contenders. I mean, from the standpoint of just straight drama and entertainment, this was edge of your seat the whole time.
Yeah, it was a great card and a great crown jewel on the top of that. You know, Fightmetric, the guys over there had made a point about the data. When you look at what Kamaru Usman does, he typically limits to an extent what his opponent can do in terms of their output. And Colby was a little bit less in that regard, let's say, relative to the Robbie Lawler fight. But the funny part was, is it looked to me, Brian Campbell, that he was fighting at Colby Covington's pace. Colby was kind of setting the tone a little bit and had some success. It could have been 2-2, could have been 3-1, depending on one's perspective of how they wanted to judge it heading into the fifth. But he kind of obliged Colby and I think beat him at his own game. Now, again, we know they're both wrestlers, but in the way in which Colby approached it, it looked like to me Kamaru was like, all right, I'll match you here, and that'll be enough of it. What's interesting about it is it's kind of a two-way street in how you want to assess whether it's good or it's bad. If you looked at what would have been better for that division in terms of fresh matchups, if that's your only consideration, it would have been Colby Covington. Because let me explain. He had only fought RDA inside anybody in the top five. Okay, and he had, of course, beaten him already. If you looked at Kamaru Usman, he had beaten everybody already in the top five, except for the one who he had not fought, which is Jorge Masvidal. So to me, we'll get to the Jorge part in just a second, but in assessing his greatness, you know, when you can wrestle in a way against RDA where you're setting the record for the most amount of strikes after you've already landed 10 takedowns, a la Cain Velasquez levels of output, if you are obliging someone who has a high pace, even if it's not the primary portion of your game in a title fight and you win, if they antagonize you by talking about your dead benefactor, and more than that, a friend, but you know, a guy who was a big part of helping to get the Black Zillions off the ground, and then talking about his incarcerated father. If you can keep cool through all of that and win, buddy, you're doing something right. You are very special. He needs more wins to do that, to really just to give some historical perspective. But what he showed on Saturday is, here's a question: is he the best welterweight walking the planet right now? I don't know how he couldn't be. Which leads us, Brian Campbell, to the next part of this, which is, do you think he will? Do you think he should fight Jorge Masvidal next?
Both would be yes right now. And I've really thought about this deeply. It's not only the best matchup to make from the rankings in terms of who's most deserving.
Well, because it's the only matchup.
It's the only matchup. And without question, Jorge Masvidal is mighty deserving. But the whole reason why you might think against that is the idea that Jorge Masvidal's celebrity star at the moment is so bright, and it's rare for somebody to get to that point organically, that is he bigger than the title? I've heard a lot of those arguments. And in this case, If it was ready to make something gigantic right now, meaning if McGregor was not coming off of a loss and it was a different scenario and you were ready right now to put Jorge Masvidal in a type of card that could be your biggest selling card of the year, I could understand that. But we're not exactly there yet. And if you're looking at the standpoint of Masvidal's brand, you want him in there against a Nick Diaz or a Conor to really maximize that and hammer it home. But the Conor fight is more of a fight to make to be honest, after he loses to Khabib in the rematch. Because at that point, it won't be about Conor McGregor, lightweight title contender. It'll be about Conor McGregor, celebrity fighter. And you can really cash in a BMF, Masvidal, Conor at any point. Jorge's still in that bubble right now that says not just a celebrity fighter, might actually be the best welterweight in the world if given a chance to prove it. That's why I think it's just a perfect setting, perfect timing. Also, the only really big matchup that makes a lot of sense, where I think you have to do that, because it's not just that his star's so bright, it's the way in which he took care of Nate Diaz that really made me go, okay, he's even better than I realized up to this point.
He is certainly a lot better, but again, if you don't make the Jorge Masvidal fight with Kamaru Usman, you have to dig into the top 6, 7, 8, because all the top five at that point,
I mean, who are you going to go? The dude that Jorge gave the three-piece to, that's the only other name available.
You're starting to fight like the Pettises and the Diazes, yes, at that point. It really begins to make not a whole lot of sense. So we'll see what happens.
Shout out to Leon Edwards. That's who I'm forgetting his name.
But of course, Kamaru already beat him. This is the point. Kind of dominated him along the way as well. Here's the thing about getting Masvidal next. Again, I go back to the fight metric numbers. How good is Masvidal? As I've said this a million times, he is good at everything. He can wrestle, he can strike, he can box. But what was the BMF title all about? Many, many, many things. But from a fighting standpoint, it wasn't anti-wrestling. It was against guys who had done what Kamaru had done, up until Saturday night. It was guys who are real heavy on positional control. And to be fair, it was actually a little bit more Colby than Kamaru, because Kamaru, unlike Colby, does a lot of ground and pound. So not exactly fair in that sense. But if you just look at some of his long 3-5-round decisions, there is obviously an element of criticism there. That's the interesting part here. I wonder if the UFC might say, well, okay, maybe he was that, but look at what he just did against Colby Covington, going for almost the full 5 rounds. Absolutely, utterly, the entire time on his feet. He was quite hittable, but also he was doing great work himself. Big power, as you noted, great gas tank the whole time.
And I don't think Colby was really ever hitting him with something that was giving him too much danger, or giving him a reason not to stay in there and try to outbox
right.
him.
I think he caught Kamaru a couple of times when he wasn't prepared for it and literally stumbled him, and also maybe stung him a little bit. I'm sure the punches hurt, but you're right, never anything to dissuade him. Also, if you've ever seen any Kamaru sparring videos with guys like Michael Johnson and other ones, he loves to get zinged a little bit and then just drive back into you, which is kind of exactly what we saw in the end. But here's my point: if you're Masvidal, while I do believe that Kamaru got a bit of a bump from this fight, bigger bump than he got from Woodley, by the way, because it was the main event and it was Colby raising the stakes in the way that he had. If you just looked at what the after fight talk was, it was really about sticking it to Colby. Whether that's fair or not, we'll talk about in a minute. It wasn't exactly in huge praise of Kamaru. It was in praise of the job Kamaru did. So I do think...
Yeah, but why wouldn't Jorge do anything else? I mean, do you think he willingly wants to go out of his way to fight a guy who can completely, potentially neutralize him?
That's my whole point. It's like, if you're Jorge Masvidal, you can wrestle and you can strike, but the data on him has been, yes, if guys can spam him with takedown attempts, he doesn't get overwhelmed to the point where he gets choked out and, like, you know, beaten to a pulp, but he might lose a decision.
Do you think from a... And I always try to stay in the headspace of what is UFC thinking, because obviously they're always thinking with the bottom line first and the metrics and the financials and all that. Do you think that Masvidal would be damaged from the kind of potential one-sided loss he could face against Usman, where it would hurt you moving forward if you wanted to match him against a Nick Diaz or against a Conor McGregor in the future? I don't think it necessarily would.
It would be a before and after thing. Whereas before we had all this interest, now we have none. I don't think it necessarily helps his brand if he goes in there and fights Kamaru Usman and then survives and has a moment here or there, but ultimately just gets out-wrestled by this big, strong, incredible guy. But if I'm Masvidal's people, and I spoke to them on the night of 244, and I asked them, what's next? Colby's got to be next if he wins. They're like, nope, not next. And I was thinking, why not? They're like, we want the biggest money possible. Do the biggest money possible. If you're right, which is Conor goes Cerrone, then Khabib, and then 170. If you're right in that, Masvidal's going to sit out, and it puts the UFC in an uncomfortable position, because now they're like, well, Kamaru is clearly our best 170. Well, Masvidal may not want to fight him. Now, Masvidal might, because he wants that title, so it could get a little complicated there. But if Masvidal decides to sit out, then you have Kamaru fighting people who are totally out of their depth.
No, it's got to be Masvidal next. I want to talk about Colby. I know you do, too.
Yeah.
So I want to interrupt you and say this. There were a lot of moral victories on this card. I thought a lot of people fared so well in defeat that raised their own stock.
Hashtag Jose Aldo.
Damn right. Colby, once again, proved a lot to me. You know what I mean? First, it's like, can this style work against certain guys? And I was like, well, Robbie Waller is going to step in and break this chain, right? No, he wins it. I wouldn't have guessed that Colby was that tough to do that for nearly 25 minutes and fight at that level and fight through a broken jaw the final two plus rounds.
How'd you have it heading into the fifth?
I had it 3-1 Kamaru, with full knowledge that one to two of those rounds could easily be flipped, because for the most part it was on even terms, and there were some rounds where Covington's volume may have edged the fact that I thought Kamaru was landing the bigger punches.
Yes.
And there were two key moments where I think right hands showed Colby visually hurt for a brief second, but that was the only sort of data we were collecting from the idea of who's landing more damaging shots. So I was fine on 3-1 Kamaru. I know that the scorecards were one slightly for Kamaru, one for Colby, and one even at that point, but huge moral victory from the standpoint that I had sort of set up a scenario that it would be all or nothing for Colby, meaning he bet on himself the last 2 years, went with this ridiculous character, trying to get everybody mad, trying to raise his stock, pissing off Dana White, pissing off anybody, and it would only pay off if he won the championship,
right?
Because I assumed he would go down in a, if he didn't win, I assumed he would go down, the plane would go down with flames. It didn't.
No.
He actually raised his stock, and I think there are plenty of marketable matchups moving forward you can make with him, going across a couple different divisions.
Yeah, Dana White even saying he liked the idea of Colby versus Tyron Woodley. Got to be honest, so do I.
Damn,
I think
right.
It's an appropriate
and with
one.
That backstory where it could get a little gross and dirty there, like right here, right?
Don't
now.
Want you to lose your notes for Slapstick Hour.
All right.
Real quickly though, let's get to it here.
No, not quickly. Let's hang in here. Don't be
I know,
afraid
Jay
of that
is
guy.
In my
Don't
Airbnb,
be afraid
like,
of him.
Let's go and talk about Bellator prelims. No,
I actually
Jay,
know how old
we talk
Jay
about the main
is.
Event. Hold on. Colby, should we feel sorry for him? Now, I absolutely think you're right about the moral victory there. I mean, again, the judges had it 3-1, 1-3, 2-2. I mean, this was very, very close. I do agree that when Kamaru hit Colby, it seemed to move him in a way that wasn't exactly the same. And again, Kamaru had that big third round before he had the big fifth round. So to me, I think I had it either 2-2 or 3-1. I stopped scoring after the first two, and I had it split at that point. But the point being is, I thought for sure the knives were going to come out, and they did come for him. Everybody was taking a shot at him. And the fact that he had his jaw broken is sort of like MMA God saying something
and
about
this. A vicious
this.
Cut under his eye, too.
But the reality is, in terms of what he showed, he made you believe that, number one, another time with Kamaru, if he makes some adjustments, he might be able to win. You certainly like his chances against anybody else in that top five, mm-hmm. for sure. I will say this, though. I saw people being like, oh, you're going to kick a guy while he's down? Well, no, I'm not. I mean, the guy broke his jaw.
But he would deserve it.
Hold
if
on.
He wanted
let me say,
him.
He broke his jaw, showing legendary heart. So as a competitor, as a guy who observes competitors, you look at that, and that is just elite-level stuff, and there's no other way to describe it other than that. But, dude, this guy went out of his way to say incendiary things about dead people, about people's
yes.
family and incarcerated people. He made fun of Matt Hughes for getting hit by a train.
He toes the line on racial stuff, too, a lot.
He cosplays as an alt-right troll, let's be honest. And so when he leaned into that character, he knew exactly what was going to happen, and he just did it anyway. It's not in me to say, oh, I'm so glad he's hurt, because I'm not. I take no joy in it. But if you feel like you want to say something about it, you are well within your right to
do so. I thought the stoppage was fine given the knowledge we knew about the jaw. His face was a grotesque, swollen mess. I get there's an argument, hey, man, there's 10 seconds to go in this fight.
The back of the head thing was bad.
Can you give him a chance? It was bad, but I really think that the referee had it full in his rights given the danger you saw on his face. Even with 10 seconds to go, it kind of harkens back to Chavez and Meldrick Taylor where it's like, man, just let him finish.
Yeah.
See what the scorecards would have been. I was fine with that. Monday morning quarterback, though, are you fine in hindsight with his strategy, in the sense that, look, I almost feel like Colby was outgunned in every category by a guy who's slightly better than him in my eyes in every single category. Looking back, should he have tried to wrestle? Rather than just go out there and say, I think my gas tank's going to outwork you, and in the end, whether it's decision or knockout, I believe in myself that I can win this fight. He couldn't do it.
I suspect if they meet a second time, there will be some adjustments like that. It's just this time going in, maybe he had an injury, maybe he felt like it'd be better for him in the long term, maybe he thought he could just get his pace going. He made a series of assumptions. I think some of them played out, and some of them didn't, so he paid for it in the end. In terms of the stoppage, I'm not mad at Mark Goddard in the sense that he saw Colby get dropped twice and then reach out with his hands, grabbing a C-grip, and then you know his face was down. So you see that, and you're not moving. I get why the referee would intervene.
You see that C-grip, you go for the C-block. That's what I'm talking about.
And so I got that a little bit. On the other hand, the punches to the back of their head, it's a problem in MMA, you know, generally. I don't think Kamaru's a dirty fighter. And Colby was still kind of in it a little bit when they immediately stopped. So, but that's just material you can sell for the rematch. Also, again, Colby handling it not with a terrible degree.
I respect him running out of the cage. It's on brand for the character.
No, but about the tweet to Mark Goddard.
Yeah, yes.
You know, it's like, I mean, I just.
I felt this whole week, by the way, that Colby was getting sick of this act, of having to do this act. And I thought a victory would have allowed him at the point to just be like, look, guys, it was an act. I'm done with it. I made it to the mountaintop.
He was dying to tell the world that it was.
Yeah. And I felt like it's going to be interesting moving forward how much he commits to that character to try to stay relevant or if he feels like he's already established that.